the message of precaution, COVID-19 pandemic, wear face masks, maintain do gaja ka duri for social distancing, focus on hand and safe hygiene.
1,000 botanic gardens and arboretum are located in 148 countries. They together maintain over 4 million living plants belonging to more than 80,000 species of vascular plants. So this you can, from this you can imagine or you can understand the importance of these botanic gardens. Here, Oldfield et al. In 1998 reported that over 7,300 tree species are globally threatened, and about 1,665 of these threatened species are maintained in different botanic gardens of the world. So that is the how these botanic gardens play a role in conservation. You can understand from this slide. So the botanic gardens and other plant conservation centers in the world thus play a very crucial role as centers for rescue, recovery, and rehabilitation of threatened plants and other valuable plant genetic resources. The botanic gardens also play important role in education and as centers of training in areas such as horticulture, gardening, landscaping, access to conservation, and environmental awareness. You see, some of the botanic gardens in the world are the best landscape garden or the most beautiful garden. So they are, it is the place for training of horticulture or gardening this landscape. That is why not only in conservation but in education or also that it plays a very important role. Here in India, the conservation strategies in our country, as a signatory to CBD, India has obligation to conserve our rich biodiversity, and we have the National Environment Policy 2006. Identified the need for enhancement of access to conservation of genetic resources in designated gene bank across the country. So here, the policy further emphasizes that the genetic material of threatened species of flora and fauna must be conserved on priority. It is therefore become essential to provide alternate protection shelter to such species. This is the thing. So in situ conservation in our country, in India, as I have told, in situ conservation is very important for the to maintain the genetic diversity. So in India, so different parts of the country, in different state, many area has been identified for in situ conservation. At present, as per this 2019, we have access to conservation under access to conservation 104 national parks in India. Then 551 wildlife sanctuaries, 18 biosphere reserve, 187 community reserve, 88 conservation reserve. Total protected area in the country comes to about 4.93%.
Yes, sir. No problem.
My PPT is visible, no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir, and giving this opportunity to speak before you. And I also thanks my director and the HO Deccan Circle Regional Center. Dr. A. Mao, my predecessor speaker, Director of Botanical Survey of India, he has beautifully narrated the role of Botanical Survey of India in conservation, and also he has given how to conserve and what are the things, what are the legal provisions to be conserved. And also he has also spoke regarding at length the benefit of the conservations for the poor and the general. The most important thing I am going to speak is what to conserve then. Because many of the students, I have seen that in that chat box, many of the students have asked what is the RET species and what is the biosphere reserve, what is the arboretum, and what is the rare endangered threatened species. It seems that the students are very much they are the starting for the botanical botanical studies, and they are the very much in the preliminary stage. And that's why it is very much important to know what to conserve actually, and what are the plants that exist in throughout the world and throughout the India particularly. And because Eastern Himalaya and Western Ghats, and suppose if you do not know what to conserve, it is very difficult to know and what is the role of other people to who are working. And before going for understanding the biodiversity, because whenever we go for speaking and whatever we go for anything, I mean, top of BSI and scientists of the country is able to add around 300 species of plant in our Indian flora. And that's why the discovery, the many taxa which is considered endemic to the different adjacent phytogeographical regions are now is a form as in fall. For example, this is a Archaeodendron which we recently collected from the Arunachal Pradesh. This is again Rubus lusostylus. Again, we collected from the different part of Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh. And Echinaceae, this is a new family record of the flora of India, what we have collected. Recently, we have added to that. These are the some of the endemic species found in Eastern Himalaya. This is Bulbophyllum. This is a Stapletonia arunachalensis. This is a new genus we have added. And Delahousie Bracteria, this is a genus we have added. Gentiana stylophora, this is again a medicinal plant. Archidendron Nelsianum, this is a new species what we have collected from India. And if you see the distribution of the Spicotyledon, this is the Eastern Himalayan area, and this is all about the Indian Himalayan states. And if you see Eastern Himalaya, this is Arunachal and Sikkim, almost it is having 30% of the total biodiversity which is found in the IHR sector. And this is again the Asteraceae, the most dominant dominant family, and Orchidaceae, the most dominant family in in Monocotyledon. And these are the only the data, and these data are the dynamic data only, and every year these data are subject to change, because if three species is collected from Orchidaceae, or three species is described or discovered from Orchidaceae, the number will change. That's why these numbers are the dynamic and change every time. This is the first dominant genera in the Eastern Himalaya again, Rhododendron again, and Primula in Sikkim. And Impatiens, this is a very interesting species, more than 62 species found in the single genus. And if you go to the single genus Rhododendron, which is dominant in this Eastern Himalayan, more than 95% of the Rhododendron is found in Eastern Himalaya, and many of the species which is found in the flower in during the month of May, April and May. And you can say around 50% species are endemic to this region only. And suppose the Rhododendron ciliatum, this is Rhododendron arboreum, this is also endemic. This is also a very widespread Rhododendron. And this is again, this is Rhododendron glaucophyllum. If somebody will visit Arunachal Pradesh or Sikkim in the month of April, this is the common type of scenery. You can able to see that Rhododendron. And this is a Rhododendron thomsoni. This is found in Arunachal Pradesh. And this is Rhododendron hooksoni. This is found around 3,000 to 4,000 meter of height. And this is a Campylocarpum. These four are we have collected from the Jhongri, that is around 4,500 meter of altitude. This is Rhododendron Campylocarpum, Glaucophyllum, and Falconeri. And the another thing is the ripes. This is known as the gooseberries, because this is not only the aesthetic view of the forest, but also how it can be utilized in the commercial way. Because ripes of the gooseberries is one of the most important species found in Himalayas or Eastern Himalayas. Out of 17 species found in Eastern Himalaya, we have around 12 species of species, and all these seeds are edible. And in European countries, these ripes are being utilized for the preparation of jams and all these edible things. And this is another thing, is Rubus. And Rubus also is a very interesting group, what we have worked out already. And during our revision studies, we found 175 species of Rubus, and these all Rubus are fruits. And this is blackberries, known as the blackberries, and also high commercial value. This is another group of plant. This is known as Codonopsis. And out of 17 species of Codonopsis, 14 species of Codonopsis is found in Eastern Himalaya. And this is known, this is otherwise known in the poor man's ginseng. And the root of this plant is utilized the same property of the ginseng. That's why this is known in the poor man's ginseng. And we have 14 species of Bodonopsis, different kind of Bodonopsis. Anybody who has can visit in month of July, he can able to see all these plants. And this is again the Bodonopsis. This is Fortinus, Ovata, and Tribulosum. This is Botanica. This is newly discovered species, and this is Bodonopsis javanicum. And gingivores, this is another space. This is another interesting group of plants which is found in the eastern Himalaya. This is Larsinanthera. We have this is a new genus described from the eastern Himalaya. Hadicium, around 56 species of Hadicium found, and these have a very fragrant flowers, and many of the cosmetic or the perfumery companies they use this plant, they use these flowers. And however, this is although this is having a this is a big diverse area of the by the changing trend of the eastern Himalaya, we see that there is a temperature rising from 1.7 degree to 2.2 degree between the last 100 years. That means that it's a change of temperature between 3.5 to 4.3 degree of centigrade. And what are the proximal drivers? What directly impact the diversity? This is clearly the forest, extension of agriculture, introduction of monoculture areas. And the ultimate the factor that is the effect indirectly mainly through the socio-economic forces or the global drivers, that is the factor that is the external origin that will influence the biota of the climate change. The global driver, this may be comes at the invasive species, or the ultimate this is the over exploitation of the forest, this is the proxima, this is the natural or the requirement of the public from the forest. And if you see the relationship between the phenology, demography, or distribution, because whenever we go for the vulnerability test, we have to go for the phenology. And this is a prediction. Before going for the prediction, you must go for the phenology of the species, that is species vulnerability, you have checked it, or prediction of the species, or whatever the sensitivity, and the retrospective analysis, how it works on the plant, and we have to see, and the community-based or indicator, you have to do that. And recently, we have worked on the floor. This is many of the indicator species. And we have tested for the phenology of the alpine zones of the, we have taken 350 species. Out of these, we have targeted for the 10 species, where the phenology of the last 100 years has been changed. That is around 53 degree of the advanced in the stage. That's why the phenology we have taken as one of the indicator of the space, indicator for the climate change. Another thing, the phytosociological attributes, we have worked out the phytosociological attributes that the regions and status, that the distribution of the trees, saplings, seedlings are usually in the study area in the entire Eastern Valley. We have worked on that, and the regions and strata of the plants and the tree species, or in the we have also calculated the diameter grid, and also the particular rhododendron group we have worked out how many seedlings are regenerating, so that we can able to see that, or we can able to predict the whether the forest will be sustainable or not. And when we see that the species selection, because vulnerability also comes as species composition, because this changes the species composition of the forest, community structure of the forest, and the change of the abundance. Suppose the plant of the specialized group, those are the saprophyte. You take the example of the saprophyte group. When we come at the saprophyte group, a slightest change in the climate, slightest change in the slightest change in the environment, the complete composition or the microclimatic condition of these saprophyte specialized plant group will destroy. So that there is a chances of these plants may they lost their natural habitat, and these plants may be either they will shift to the another habitat, or they will extinct from the particular habitat. This is again the Papilopodium. The many of the species like Papilopodium or orchids are also will be affected by this. So that's why when we talk about the conservatory priorities, because inventory of the biodiversity is the prerequisite for the understanding the all level of ecosystem services. That is the number one. The flora of Himalaya is manifested a high degree of species richness and endemism. My request is to all the newly inducted botany students, their role comes over here, the inventory of biodiversity, what the BSI is doing. They can also go for the intake of independent projects or independent work, or the conserve the scientifically management rich virus flowering plants, the Himalaya is well established, or inventory or monitoring. Because unless you don't know how to inventory or what the plants to be invented, what the plant has to be conserved, the entire process of conservation processes go waste. That's why the most important thing is know about the plants. And not only the Eastern Himalaya, this has to be what are the maybe in your own area, maybe in your own universities, or maybe in your own locality, you must know what are the plants around you and what are the plants give the benefit to you. Presently, the fourth point is presently we have Eastern Himalaya, the two, only two biosphere reserves and the 18 national parks, and 18% and 17% of wildlife sanctuary. That's why there is a greater importance we have to take in the ministerial level or in the government level, so that many areas can come under the protected area network. Because the Himalayan region not only covers under the protected area network, but also with the framework of the transboundary cooperative survey, that is the Kanchenjunga landscape. Recently, it has been worked out, and the continuous ecosystem shared by the Bhutan, India, and the Nepal. And this is the vulnerability. Dr. Mao also shown many of the slides where the vulnerability or the many of the restrictions seen. And if you visit in a common man, will visit into the forest of Eastern Himalaya. This is the common things you can see in the roadsides. And the big logs that have been converted into small plants. And this is the collection of unscientific collection. I can say the unscientific collection of the rattans from the forest. And this is the complete destruction of the forest for the shifting cultivation. You can see the area under the huge and virgin forest. And this is the complete, this is maybe under 100 years or 50 years forest has been completely destroyed. And that's why we can say that in the finally that the Eastern Himalayan, this harbors a very magnificent plant diversity and also ample evidence that indicates the plant diversity of this region is vulnerable and gradually affected. And the decline of this diversity, not only the change in the ecosystem, but also the socio-economic condition, because many of these people are directly or indirectly dependent upon this forest. And many crucial information regarding the changes of plant physiology, population structures, distribution and plants at different altitudes have to be evaluated through a series of primary data. Because though we have a primary data, the more and more work has to be done, the more way work and more new things we can able to know that. And more protected areas to build in the in-situ conservation, that is one of the most important things, so we can go for that one. And if you'll see that the last slide, I can able to see that they look closely to a nature. This is applicable to everybody, and every species is a masterpiece, exquisitely adapted to the particular environment in which it has survived. Who are we to destroy and even diminish the biodiversity? This is E.O. Wilson's thought, and I hope that this thought is applicable to everybody as in today. And thank you very much. This is my last one. Thank you. Hello.
Sir, I thank to Dr. Dash for giving informative keynote address on Indian biodiversity hotspots, Eastern Himalaya characteristic and diversity. Thank you so much, sir. Now, Dr. L. Rasingam, the scientist today, has been working in Botanical Survey of India since 2011. He has a research experience of around 15 years. His main interest in floristics and ecological assessments, non-detrimental findings, and ethnobotanical studies. He has a vast experience on island flora and extensively explored the remote islands of Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Southern Western Ghats, Deccan Plateau, and Eastern Ghats. He has described 12 species new to science and reported many species to flora of India and other phytogeographical regions. Recently, he has completed the Minister of Environment, Forest, Climate Change funded project entitled Non-Detrimental Findings, Studies on Red Sanders Tree in India. He has authored 3 books and more than 80 research papers in national and international journals. Now I request Dr. L. Rasingam to present his topics. Dr. Rasingam.
Good morning, everybody. Well, I am very much thankful to our beloved director, Dr. Mao sir, and our head of office, Dr. P.V. Pasana sir, and our technical in charge section, Dr. Das sir, for giving this opportunity. And here I am going to give a brief introduction about this Deccan Regional Centers and its role, responsibility, and the achievements for the past 15 years. So as everybody aware of that, DSI have a regional centers all over India, and they are all
You are not audible. Things have stopped, I think. There is a connection problem, I think.
It's coming.
Connect down there.
Go to there. Yeah. You can speak about some technical.
No, if you they will speak. I'll connect. Shall I connect there?
Means this one? One minute. It is coming and going. Connected.
Mine is connected. Okay, you can speak. We will see there. Second time, no. I can speak. Sir.
So here you can see the number of Brachystelma species. So almost 7 species are there. So among the 7, only. Among the 7, 6 species are described after 2012. So there is a necessary to intensively explore this Andhra Pradesh and Odisha state. So that is the reason this regional center was established in 2006.
Sir, it's not visible.
Please share the screen.
Your presentation is not visible. You are audible, but your presentation is not visible.
Wait. Oh, yes. Is it visible now? So this regional center has been developed in 2006 and population control matter field for 2 years. Then later started to almost 1K in camper.
Sir, your audio is still breaking.
Yes, yes.
And this is the
presentation is also, I think it has got stuck. Your presentation is also got stuck and I think audio is also having some problem.
Next person. Due to problem because yesterday was heavy rain was there in Hyderabad. So we lost all electricity, everything.
Oh.
Hello. Here some technical errors came. So now I am next participant.
Some technical error is happening. Now I request next speaker, Mr. Ravikiran Arigala. Mr. Ravikiran Arigala obtained his master's degree in botany from Andhra Loyola College, Vijayawada. Presently, he is working as botanical assistant in Botanical Survey of India from 2013 onwards. He has published more than 12 publications, 21 publications, including 1 new to science and 5 new distribution records to India. He explored Indian desert, western ghats of Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu. Now I request Mr. Ravikiran Arigala to present his lecture. Mr. Ravikiran Arigala, please. Dear participant, sorry for inconvenience due to some technical error, electricity problem. Just a minute.
Please unmute, Ravi Kiran.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes. Carry on. Ravi.
Okay. Yes, yes.
Yeah, good afternoon all. Firstly, thank you Botanical Survey of India and audience for the opportunity. So let us go to the topic. Role of Botanical Survey of India and Bioresources Conservation. So why we need to protect our biodiversity and bioresources? As we are getting the several ecological services for our livelihood, it is our duty to protect. If you do not protect the bioresources, there will be no life on the earth. That too, it is our ethical and historical responsibility to carry forward this to our next generations for their survivalence. And where we get these resources? Generally, we have two major ecosystems. One is the terrestrial and as well as the aquatic ecosystem. In these terrestrial ecosystems, as per the Champion and Seth classification, we have 16 major type of forest types. In those, we can have a grassland, shola, savanna, wet evergreen, dry evergreen, and dry deciduous forest. And if you go to the Indian desert, we have a different type of vegetation and you have the tropical forest, temperate forest, and as well as the mangroves. And if you take the sea, we have the sea grasses and sea vegetation, sea algae. And if we have the freshwater vegetation, we have like freshwater algae. And these many resources we have, in those resources, we have a different kind of biodiversity. And how this biodiversity is influencing? What are the factors we'll see? And the first one is the evolution. And the atmosphere, altitude, speciation, extinction. If you take the evolution, that the evolution rate is high, then we can expect a higher rate of biodiversity. In the same way, the atmosphere is good, and we can expect a good biodiversity in that particular region or ecosystem. Altitude, generally it plays a dominant role in delimiting the biodiversity, either in the higher weights or lower weights. If you go to the hill peaks, like our Das sir explained, or director sir explained, that the rhododendron diversity is very good at Himalayan region. If you come to the southern areas, we can have only 2-3 species at the Western Ghats, because the altitude plays a major role in that. And the speciation, and whenever the speciation rate, it means a creation of the new species in between the crossbreeding and something, and we can expect a higher rate of biodiversity. And the extinction, with the extinction, due to the several threat factors to the biodiversity, if the extinction rate is high, we can have a lower biodiversity. The same like an area. If the area is larger and bigger, and we can expect a good biodiversity in the particular areas. And disturbances factors. And if there is the disturbance in that particular ecosystem, then we have a declining rate of biodiversity in that particular area. And the migration. Several birds and some other animals, creatures, they will migrate every year. And these migrations also causes for the biodiversity growth and declining. And we can have a glance on that threat factors to the biodiversity. One is the habitat destruction and invasive species and collection of firewood, mining, and pollution. There are several factors, they are threatening the biodiversity.
We'll just have a look on this habitat destruction. For a developing nations like our country, we need to build a new road network. And these networks sometimes going through through the wildlife sanctuaries, national parks and all. Whenever we destruct these habitats, definitely the local biodiversity, the particular animals or plant species which are confined to the particular area, they will get disturbed. And in the same way in the mining, so we are getting for granite and some other minerals, we are doing the mining, and this will destruct that habitat, and we will have the lower rate of biodiversity, and the biodiversity will be declining in these particular areas. And invasive species, as that habitat destruction is a major cause, and this is the second biggest threat for the biodiversity, and these species will compete the local or native flora, and they will replicate like in a higher rate. So gradually that the local vegetation will extinct from that particular region. And see here, this is from Western Ghats, Kodaikanal Wildlife Sanctuary, and Ajuratina Adenophora, you can see it's gone into the deep forest of the Sholas, and they make the gaps in that particular areas. When the porosity, if you go to the next slide, if any impact forest, there will be no disturbance, then we can expect a good biodiversity here. And if once this invasive species or encroachments or human settlements go into the forest, and there will be a porosity, and the species slowly move away from that particular area and where they cannot exist, so then there is a chance for that species loss. And another factor, if you come to the pollution and undegradable products, you can see that last slide, last one, that it is on Mount Abu. Due to the heavy pilgrims and heavy tourists, they are leaving the plastics and all. So they are non-degradable, and the ground vegetation, whatever it is, there is a chance for extinction. If you see the Kodaikanal Wildlife Sanctuary, you can see the streams which are going through the city, and it leads to the downhills. There, in between that, from top hills to the downhills, you can see the plenty of the non-degradable products inside that. And wherever the moist areas are there, where the species lie in the industrial influence, and these chemicals will disturb the freshwater algae as well as the freshwater fishes and other creatures which are living in that particular ecosystem. And these forest fires, and an acre of a tropical forest contains 180 metric tons of carbon. So once these forests goes, where we can expect its carbon sequestration, where we can store this much of carbon in the atmosphere. So, and this is one of the threat factor. And if you go to the anthropogenic pressures, the very simple factors, how higher rate they are disturbing the biodiversity. We take that Annamalai Tiger Reserve, and one brick factory is situated there, and there is no buffer zone at all, because even government has declared to maintain the buffer zone for 2 kilometers, and there is no buffer zone at all. And here we have observed that whenever the wild animals, they are coming for the water, especially in the summer season, these industry people, they are hunting and they are killing those animals. And if you see the when the road network through the forest, and you can see the plastic waste in Shola forest, and illegal tree cuttings, and illegal tapping of the water from Shola springs. This is one of the best example for the threat for the biodiversity. Especially if you take the Western Ghats, you can have the springs like this. These springs will form these small rivulets. These rivulets will become a big canals, and it comes to the lower hills as they forms a big lake. And when the natural flow is disturbed, and these local people, estate people, they are stealing the water from that through the drip pipes in the particular Shola springs, and the natural flow of the Shola stream will be disturbed, and the species whichever they are going on that particular stream, they will disappear from that area. And like a poaching, so for sake of believing some mythological things, and as well as for the some cosmetic products, we are killing the wildlife, and this will disturb the biodiversity. And like smuggling, tourism, pilgrimage, and mass tourism. Earlier we used to offer something for the god. Now the people have started offering the liquor to the god also, and they're throwing the different garbages. And if you are allowing the people in the natural areas like Eastern Himalayas and Western Ghats, and there will be a lot of cloud, and the local vegetation will be disturbed, and local fauna also will be disturbed, and road kills. When you are moving through, making the roads towards the natural parks and wildlife sanctuaries, these innocent wild animals, they are not aware of this speeding vehicles, because every year they choose a different path to select the mating partner and to search for a food. They go in a different ways, and they are not aware of these vehicles. So when they are moving the crossing the roads, they are hitting the vehicles, and we are losing the biodiversity in this way. And the concretization, it is a very simple thing, and our authorities, they are not at all minding about the plants. It is like a tying a rope to our at our neck. So when that basal area of the tree, it has been concretized, how the rainwater will be percolated into the ground, how groundwater levels will be increased. And the tar and the concrete, it causes the latent heat, and plant shows the more rate of evaporation. This evaporation leads to the permanent wilting. And this is also one of the threat factor. So now we'll discuss about the Botanical Survey of India role. We have seen these many threats. They are declining the biodiversity in an alarming rate. And how to conserve this biodiversity? For the, considering this threat aspects, our Botanical Survey of India, it has set up the different regional centers at different parts of the country based on the particular geographic region and particular vegetation type. And here we have the different regional centers I just mentioned here. And earlier my director also explained about this. And we have a motto that we wanted to explore and document the vegetation of the entire country of the different geographical parts. And conservation of germplasm in the form of Orchidarium, Cactarium, and the botanical gardens. And we have the collaboration with the national and international organizations towards the conservation. And for example, if you take a Botanical Survey of India Deccan Regional Center, we have the jurisdiction like three states, Orissa, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh. In this particular area, our teams will go to the surveys and they will explore the vegetation data. And what is conservation? How the BSI surveys related to the conservation? What is conservation? So bringing the plants from the forest and keeping them in the parks or botanical gardens, or bringing the animal, captivating the animal, the zoos, is it a conservation? No. Then what to conserve and where to conserve and who is conserving it? So many of the organizations, as they're involving for the conservation, our Botanical Survey of India under the ministry, we are involving for the conserving the natural resources of country in the two ways. One is the indirect conservation, and another one is the direct conservation. First one is how the explorations and documentation of vegetation wealth of the country, it leads to the conservation. As Dr. Sudhakar Reddy says, that effectively conserve any endemic and threatened species. And we need a comprehensive document of the particular ecosystem to conserve the particular species or of endemic or threatened. And we train the local governing authorities like a forest department people, because they stand as a frontline warriors for the conservation of the area. And we create awareness among the public we promote them to conserve the nature and natural resources. And in the direct conservation, how the BSI are involving in the direct conservation? It's like we have a germplasm bank like botanical gardens, arcidoriums, bamboo zetum, and cactoriums, and several other EET plant gardens. And we have the experts in the tissue culture. Whenever we go for a surveys, we bring the plants, threatened plants, and we will multiply them in our labs. And we'll rehabilitate in them in natural habitats. We can have a glance on that explorations, how we conduct it. So our teams will conduct surveys in Himalayas, Northeast India, and Western Ghats. And wherever we have a jurisdiction, regional center that we have a jurisdiction, in that particular jurisdiction, our teams will work. And apart from that, we have experts, they work in entire India. And you can see that first picture that our team is working at Himalayan region, and Dr. Altaf's team is working at Western Ghats, and Mr. Anant and all, they are working at Sikkim regions. And apart from that, our BSI had different efforts and different plant groups. Like we have experts in higher group, as my director told that we cover entire vegetation of the country. And we have angiosperm experts and gymnosperm experts, and we have lichen experts, and we have biofit experts, we have pteridophytes experts, and we have algae experts. And our algae experts, they used to go Antarctica and Arctic regions. They're exploring the vegetation with the international teams. As I said, that we have a collaboration with the international teams. And you can see Dr. Balaswamy and Dr. Sudhir and his team. They have covered east coast of India, and they have documented the sea grasses. And this document, it is useful that how many indigenous species we have, how many are economically important and all. So these data, it is a primary database to conserve any species. It is much more helpful. We have experts in the fungus, Dr. Kanath Das and his team, and they explore the fungi from entire India. And apart from the other plant groups, we conduct the non-NDF studies, EA studies, and sacred groups. How these studies will relate are related to conservation? Because these NDF studies, recently our Deccan Regional Center, they have completed the NDF for red sanders. If any local governing authority, like a forest department or state government of Andhra Pradesh, they want to cut the red sander, there should be a scientific way. How many to be cut, what to be cut, when to be cut. These has to be given by our BSI only, because we have conducted a survey with our team, and they have given particular certain guidelines to the government of Andhra Pradesh, which to be cut, what to be cut, when to be cut. Like this, we have experts, they do surveys, they do NDF studies on endemic plants, like we have here, Cycas bedomi, Dr. Shankar Rao and his team, they have completed the NDF study. And they have given a report to the forest department and how many has to be, what is the present status of that plant and how many individuals are there in a particular geographical region and where to conserve, which is the suitable location and all that our scientists will give the guidelines. And apart from that, we have the EA studies, and any government, central government or state government, they want to construct any dam in a particular wildlife sanctuary or national park. Our team will go there and visit that area, and they will explore that. What are the plants are there? What are the endemics are there? What are the threatened plants are there in a particular area? Based on that, they will, our team will give the recommendation to the particular governments to either to construct a dam or it has to be stopped. And like that, we have experts. They do the surveys for the sacred groves, which is one of the oldest tradition for the conserving of the plants. So if you declare any area as a sacred goose, people believe that it has some mythological powers and they will not disturb that particular areas. Those surveys also our BSI will conduct, and we give the equipped labs like Eldron microscope and dissective microscope. All are attached with these computers, and we study the as much as possible characters of the plants to determine and delimit the species. And once that surveys is completed and our identification, the other processes are over, we release the documents in the form of floras. Here you can see the Orchids of India. It means Orchids of India means entire database of orchids which are available in India, you have your in hand. And in that book, you can get that what is the present status of the particular orchid and where it is available. And based on the data, you can conserve that particular orchid species either by selecting a in vitro conservation or in vivo conservation. And the same way, we have endemic vascular plants, how many endemic plants are there in India, because these documents are the baseline for the conservation. Without document, then there will be question raises that what to conserve, where to conserve. Then those questions our BSI is resolving. And if our survey is completed, we focus on entire vegetation which is there in that particular area which has given to the our department for the surveys. We can see here Eleocarpus blascoi. It is the one and only living individual in the wild. And we have the rhododendron electricum. As Dashar has shown the endemic rhododendrons of the particular geographical region. And if you come to the Western Ghats, you can see that the rhododendron came. Like that, this is why we BSI has established its regional centers in the particular geographical areas of the country. And you can see the diversity in this slide. One, we have the tree species, two tree species like endemic plants we have covered. We have covered the impatiens, and we have covered the strobilanthus, we have covered the orchids, we have covered the grasses. We'll cover the entire vegetation of the particular geographical region when it is allotted to the BSF for the surveys, and these documents we use for the conservations. And apart from that, we have botanical gardens, especially the, you know that in Kolkata we have a very huge garden. There we are conserving 14,122 plant species. And we have a botanical garden at the Republic Noida. And it is kind of a garden where we can maintain the urban biodiversity also. The concept is increasing. Now it is more famous because wherever the polluted areas are there, there we are trying to restore the natural vegetation by growing the local vegetation in that particular area. And here, this area, we are using it as an experimental garden. And we are trying to introduce the as many as the endemic and threatened plants to conserve here. We are procuring the plants from the different parts of the India, and we are planting here. And presently here we have 26 threatened plants. And in this way, the BSI is involving in the conservation of the natural resources. And as my director Mahava sir has shown that we have Archidoriums. If you take that National Archidorium and Experimental Garden at ARCAD, there we have the 179 orchid species. And there we are conserving these species in the garden itself, and as well as we are multiplying them, and we are rehabilitating the particular their native areas. Like whenever my team, Dr. Palani Swami and other team, they goes for the surveys in Agastya Malaya and Western Ghats areas, they bring that endemic orchids, and they will multiply here, and they will again rehabilitate in the particular regions. In Kolkata, our team, they are trying to plant this one mangroves to protect that soil and from the soil erosion. And we have the EET garden at Shillong, and we have a cactarium at Jodhpur. Apart from that, we in the NYEZ ARCAD, we are conserving the Vernonia shoranges, which is endemic to the Chevra Hills. Like this, we choose the endemic and threatened plants of the particular geographical region, and wherever the regional center is there, which is attached to the botanical garden or museum, there we try to conserve the plant species and plant natural resources. And this is from Shillong, this National Archidorium. And as I told that we have expert in tissue culture, Dr. Kalamurthy, and the team is from Shillong. They used to work on EET plants. And we have a herbarium here. My colleague Swami will stress more on this subject. And we have a museum attached to the BSI sections. This will act as a demonstration section. Whenever the visitors visits our museums, it creates some interest among them towards the conservation. And as my director told earlier, we have a special scheme to the assistance to Botanic Garden. Here we are giving the financial aid to the different universities in India, and we are encouraging them for conservation of the particular species which they are available in the particular geographical region. Here you can see Dr. Madhusudan Reddy from standing with the Hildegardia papilifolia and Cycas bedomi, which are endemic to the Rayalaseema area of Andhra Pradesh. There we are financially supporting them, and we are conserving the particular plant species in the particular geographical region, and we are trying to multiply them, and as well as we transfer these few of the plants to our Noida garden, and there also we succeeded that they are growing well. And apart from our studies reveals very different ecological services of the plants in the particular geographical region. We can see some plants, they act as the soil binders, some they can be used as a fodder, some they are as a tidal barriers, and few are like medicinal plants. These are all the data, it comes from our surveys. These surveys will enhance the knowledge of the particular concerned teams, and where they can conserve them in that particular regions, like by declaring the MPCS, medicinal plant conservation areas and all. And we have experts, they can study the plants with the pollinators. For example, now it's become a trend to establish a butterfly garden. For some areas they are establishing that butterfly garden. Sir, we have these many species of butterflies. then where the butterflies are feeding, where they are laying the eggs, from where they are collecting the nectar and all, these plants will be surveyed by our Botanical Survey of India, and we can reveal that on which plant this particular butterfly is laying egg, and which plant it is taking the using as a food plant. So in this way, the BSI involves in the conservation of a particular species which is depend on the plants. And if you take the plant-bird interactions, and as part of protected area network in India, our BSI has taken up the projects in our several bird sanctuaries and wildlife sanctuaries. Everybody talks about that these bodies, especially if you take the Nilgiri pipit, and it is endemic to the Nilgiri Hills and Kerala and Tamil Nadu. And they says that it is an endemic bird to the Nilgiris and that particular hills. And why it is endemic, what kind of grass it requires, that it will be revealed by the BSI only. We have a grass experts like Dr. Prasanna and Dr. Altaf, and his book has come like a flora of Tamil Nadu grasses. In that book, he has mentioned that in which species, in particular habitats of this Nilgiri pipit, he has explored the grasses, and we have a document. If you want to conserve that bird, we need to know that which grass it is depending on. So that has to be, that grass has to be protected. And again, if you see the plant animal interactions, here also our BSI role is there. Because as we are conducting the surveys for several tiger reserves, like NSTR, Amarabad Tiger Reserve, our teams are working. And the forest officials should say that this year, sir, man-animal conflict has increased. Sir. These animals are coming outside, they're lifting the cattle, and are like that, they used to say. Now, what is the reason? Something is missing in that particular ecosystem. So what it is? Because the animals, these top carnivores, tiger, they require the herbivores. Herbivores completely, they depend on the grasses. The grasses, now their number is very limited because of the several invasive species, some other grassland fires or something. So these grasses has to be first studied that to protect that tiger. Like we have taken up the project of grasses of Telangana, and our colleague Dr. Mr. Nagaraj is working on that for a particular for entire state. So our floras will reveal that what kind of grass is there, how many grass species are there in a particular state. So these grasses can be consumed by these herbivores. If you maintain the good number of these herbivores in the particular wildlife sanctuary, you can easily conserve the tiger. So in this way, our BSI is involving in the conserving the national resources. If you take the black bucks at Point Kenamare Wildlife Sanctuary, you can see at the sambar deer in the Nilgiri grasslands, bison at Kodaikanal grassland. Like that, whatever the grass it is feeding on that, whenever our teams will go for a surveys, we are recording that grasses and we are documenting it. And like ethnobotanical studies, our teams are there, and they are particularly one section is there. They are working on the ethnobotanical studies, and here we document the livelihoods of the different tribal communities in India. And the information of wild relatives. Few of our sites, like Southern Regional Center, they have a tie-up with the university, Tamil Nadu Agriculture University, especially with the Plant Genetic Resources Department. And our teams will conduct a surveys, undertake the surveys for this department. They wanted to find out the wild relatives of the cultivated plants. So those we identify these plants, and we'll inform to the universities, and they will carry out the plant breeding experiments on a particular genus or species to provide the enhanced yield for the growing population of the country. So it involves the protecting the natural resources and finding the new varieties for the growing population. And we do conduct academic programs, and here Dr. Rasing will stress on this, how the academic programs leads to the conservation. And we have our training programs, like our scientists and the scientific staff, they train the local authorities like a forest department, and we'll teach them what to be conserved, what is the indigenous plant, what is the exotic plant, and where to be conserved, what is the particular character of this plant, and we'll teach them. And because they are at the ground, because if you train them and the conservation aspects, it goes in a proper way. And augmentation of green skills. As part of Skill India program of the Government of India, we have started a green skill development program, and we train the unemployed youth here, and we'll take their services for the conducting the surveys for our national parks and wildlife sanctuaries, and these skills will be utilized for the conserving the natural resources. And apart from that, we are also training them to get employment outside and environmental protection awareness. So here we have a different type of programs. We observe the Earth Day, Environmental Day, and we create the awareness, and we start we'll conduct a greening plantation, greening programs to maintain the urban biodiversity. Thank you. Thank you all.
I thanks to Mr. Avikaran Arikala for his presentation, bioresource conservation. Now I request Dr. L. Rasinga. Previously, you know, sorry for interruption, Dr. L. Rasinga presentation was interrupted due to connectivity problem. Now it is rescheduled now. Now I request Dr. L. Rasinga.
Your mic just mic is off. Your microphone is off, I think.
Yes.
Yes.
Again, sorry for the interruptions due to some connectivity problem and power problems. This presentation was interrupted very badly. So now I will present that overview of Deccan Regional Center. I think is it visible?
Yes.
I think visible. Presentation is visible.
Yes, visible, sir.
Yes. So, first of all, I'm very much thankful to our director and head of office and our coordinator for this webinar and giving this opportunity to present an overview of Deccan Regional Center. Here, I'm going to briefly tell about that. About the Deccan Regional Center, what is their role, responsibilities, and what are the achievements for the 15 years. As everybody aware of that, BSI have almost 12 regional centers throughout the country, and before 2006 it was only 10 regional center was there, and the entire Andhra Pradesh and Odisha part was taken. If you mention some area means Visakhapatnam, Nallamala Forest, and some part of Warangal districts, and the southern part of Eastern Ghats, Andhra Pradesh, that is Seshachalam Biosphere Resource. But still, we feel it is maximum area is underexplored or unexplored. So here I will show you one photo. It will give you a clear picture about how much area is still remaining unexplored or underexplored. Among the 7 Brachystelma species, except this Brachystelma maculatum, all other 6 species are described after 2012. So you can assume that still how much species are still not identified. So due to this reason, and apart from that, as per the BSI 12th 5-year plan mandate, we have to establish a DNA molecular lab up to Hyderabad. Due to these 2 reasons, we established a regional center in Hyderabad, which was established in January 2006. And initially it was functioned from Andhra Pradesh Pollution Control Board for a period of 2 years. Later it was shifted to Zoological Survey of India campus. It is almost functioned a decade at Zoological Survey of India. Last year we have shifted our office to Kendriya Southern Koti. That photo you can see that our office building. And we have a jurisdiction of Andhra Pradesh, Odisha. Yeah, initially it was Andhra Pradesh and Odisha. Later it was because of this new Telangana state. Now we have a three state of jurisdictions. So our main objective is to undertake intensive and extensive floristic surveys and collect accurate information on the distribution, ecology, and economic value of the plants in the states of Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, and Odisha. Then we used to collect, identify, and distribute plant materials and information for the purpose of research, education, and knowledge development also. Every year, normally we used to get almost 200, 300 pharmacy students. They used to come here for authentication purpose. Then we also serve as a custodian of authentic plant collection in the form of herbaria and to document the same for the preparation of local and state and national floras. And these are the views of our herbarium. And we are having almost 20,000 specimens. And the acronym of our herbarium is BSID. And the most of the collection areas are from Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, Odisha, Tamil Nadu, and Telangana. Apart from our collections, there are some universities, they also donated some of the specimen, particularly SK University and the Venkatagiri College, Nellore district, and some of the specimens from Professor Nagvi, Karimnagar district, also we have in our herbariums. And when we started this herbarium, we doesn't have any type specimens. Presently, we have a type specimen of 35 species, and we also have a lichen lab, and we have maintaining a separate lichen herbarium also. It is around 950 are preserved in the lichen herbariums. Then we are almost digitized our resources, particularly this old herbarium seat, everything. 75% of the herbarium seats are already digitized, and remaining are we are doing that. And once the server, everything is allotted, it may be given to the public access. And in the and also we developed the computer generated field label. One of our scientific staff, he developed this computer generated field label, and this has been distributed to almost all the circles. Earlier we used to write it all the field label in the handwriting, and many of them now very difficult to read. Now we made this and circulate to all the regional centers, and many of them are following this also. And we have a small museum having around 300 number of carpological collections, and a small library holding around 1,365 books, particularly pertaining to the flora of our jurisdictions. And apart from that, national flora, then we have a flora of Malaysia, Thailand, United Russia. Then we have subscribing almost 16 journals. Among the 16, 11 are national journals, and five are foreign journals, mostly related to the flora work. And we have sufficient research facilities. We have a high-end microscope with cameras, which is catering the scientific taxonomical research of these regional centers. And for us, preparation of GIS, particularly maps and all, we have a separate workstations. And lichen lab have a separate facilities, like almost all Leica microscopes and other accessory instrumentations. Presently, this regional center have a three scientists. First, Dr. P.V. Prasanna, he is the scientist G and in charge, and he is an expert in the Poaceae family. Then myself, I'm as already Dr. Sankar Rao told about me, and Dr. Sankar Rao, scientist C, he is mostly working on the ethnobotanical aspect of plants and as well as the sacred groves of Andhra Pradesh. Then we have some four scientific staffs. Dr. Sonalada is a lichenologist. She has developed a new lichen lab in Deccan Regional Centers. And Mr. S. Nagaraju, he is expert in Poaceae, and he is working on the Poaceae of Telangana. And he has a vast knowledge on the GIS platform as well as the line drawings and all. And Dr. J. Swami, he has a lot of knowledge on this Andhra Telangana flora, particularly Eastern Ghats. He is very, very much expert. He has a very much expertise in those eastern Ghats floras. And Mr. A. Ravikiran, he has recently joined. Earlier he was in Coimbatore and he worked on the flora of Kodaikanal wildlife sanctuary. After the establishment of these regional centers, there are some 7 to 8 projects we have already completed. These are all in-house projects. The first project we have taken is the flora of Greater Hyderabad regions, because Greater Hyderabad is fast developing city in India, and we want to explore. Our main aim is to explore the urban biodiversity of Greater Hyderabad. While exploring this Greater Hyderabad area, our scientists have described one new species, that is Ledaboria hyderabadensis. And apart from the new species, two new records have been recorded for the flora of India. And one book also, Trees of Hyderabad, also published. It is the outcome of this flora of Greater Hyderabad. And the next one is non-detrimental finding studies on the Cycas vetomi. So this is as per the MOEF request we have taken up and submitted our report in 2013. And this another three projects are very important and major projects. First one is Flora Seshachalam Biosphere Reserves, Andhra Pradesh. It was taken up in 2012 and ended in 2017. During this flora work, our scientists have described so many new species from this Seshachalam Biosphere Reserves. I will show all the new species described from these areas and other areas in the coming slides. Then another one is flora of Nagarjunasagar Srisailam Wildlife Sanctuary, Andhra Pradesh. It was initiated in 2012 and ended in 2017. It was executed by me. And during this study, we have described two new species and recorded some of the new records. And another one is Sacred Groves of Andhra Pradesh, an assessment. As per the earlier studies, there are 600 sacred groves are reported from Andhra Pradesh. But we want to assess whether it is really a sacred grove or simply merely a temple. So we want to assess that sacred groves. So we have taken a project and completed the project in 2017. Based on our observation and our studies, around 90 sacred groves are really a sacred groves. Remaining are merely a temple or simply a worshipping place, something like that. And then inventory of macro lichen diversity of Odisha state, which was taken up by the Dr. Swarnalada and completed the report in 2019. Then under the Flora of India programs, Dr. Sankar Rao has completed the Sauroraceae family. And we as BSI, we used to take often research scholars under the Flora of India programs. Up to now, there are 3 research scholars worked under the Flora of India programs. The first one is Dr. Alok Chorge. Presently, he is working in National History Museum, and his topic is Grasses of Odisha. He completed this work on 2015. The next one is Flora of Sarkosia Tiger Reserve from 2013 to 2018, which was undertaken by Dr. Chandra Mohan. He is also now working in a Forest Survey of India, and he also published some novelties. And the third one is Flora of Kaval Tiger Reserve, and this also the same period 2013-18, which was executed by Dr. P.S. Annamma, presently working in National Biodiversity Authority. Then presently these are the ongoing project in the Deccan Regional Center. The first one is Flora of India Poaceae under the leadership of Dr. P.V. Prasanna. We are working hard to complete this Flora of India Poaceae part. And the Flora of Manjira Wildlife Sanctuary, which was executed by me, I'm executing. Then Flora of Kinnarasini Wildlife Sanctuary by Dr. Swami, and Grasses of Telangana by Dr. Nagaraju. Under the Flora of India, now we have a research scholar in our regional center. He is Mr. Magesh. He is working on the Flora of Papikonda National Park, Andhra Pradesh. And apart from the regular in-house project, we have some funded project. The first one is studies on taxonomy, phytogeography, and conservation of South Indian heaven area, which was executed by Dr. K. Prasad. He has described
so many new species from this project. He explored almost entire South India for the Habanaria project, and he has described so many new species from this project. And the next one is preparation of NDF report for the red standard tree in India, which was MOF CC funded project, which was executed in 2018 to 2019. So we have explored the, we have assessed the red standard population, how it is decreasing and how it is affecting. All we have assessed through field surveys and submitted the report to the ministry. And based on this research work, this regional centers has regional center and regional center scientist has published 5 books. The first one is Trees of Hyderabad, a pictorial field guide. It is having around 270 plant species with full of photographs, which was released in the during the COP11 meeting held at Hyderabad in 2012. Some of the other plants, some of the other books, pictorial field guides are published by the scientists of these regional centers. This is for forest plant of Nilagiris and Telangana biodiversity field guide. This also having around 800 photographs of Telangana, particularly Telangana regions, and the floristic diversity of Pocharam Wildlife Sanctuary was executed by Swami during his PhD time, and it was also published. And with the collaboration of
are critically endangered. Among 6,557 species are listed in the endangered category. So vulnerable category, there are 7,430 species. Altogether, we have 17,507 species are facing high risk of extinction in the wild. So coming to our India, there are, as per the Barrick et al., around 2,700 species, plant species, belongs to the 1,031 genera and 270 families are listed in the threatened plants category. To assess these plants, actually, whatever is the threatened plants, whatever is the endemic plant, to assess this particular one, without assessing these plants, it's not possible to conserve the species, whatever if it is endemic or threatened. Until assessment that plant, it's not possible to conserve. For that assessment of the particular species or any threatened species, herbarium plays very important role. How it plays important role? Because herbarium having the when we are studying ample of data we used to collect, this data helpful for us to assessment of those species. When if it is comes under the threatened category, we can conserve those particular species. So today's my topic is role of herbarium in conservation. This is very small presentation. So actually, what is the herbarium? We know about the herbarium. Just herbarium is the storehouse of dried and pressed plant specimens collected from different places. That means from sea level to the high altitude, high alpine level. There are different gradient level. These species are plant specimens are mounted in appropriate sheets, in particular size of sheet, that is 28 into 41 centimeter, 42 centimeter plus and minus one. These particular sheets only will mount. These sheets finally we arranged into according to an approved system of classification. Here approved system of classification means we have 3 different system of classification. One is artificial system of classification, another is natural system of classification, and phylogenic system of classification. Any of the system of classification we can adopt while arranging this herbarium. Most of the Commonwealth countries, especially in our India also, we are using Bentham and Hooker system of classification for arranging this herbarium. So actually this art, the art of herbarium, when did the art of herbarium start? This special technique is initiated by Professor Luca Gini. He's an Italian professor in the midpoint of the 16th century, so in Italy. So after this technique is followed by a naturalist, a Gerard Sebo, is followed this technique. In the middle part at the 16th century, and Aldrovando, Cisalpino from Italy and Turner from England, they also continued this art of technique. So first herbarium of the world is University of Padua, it's Italy. It was established in 1545, in the year of 1545. Actually, what they did in earlier, so they used to collect more than 3 to 4 plant specimens are dried separate. They used to mount in the one particular sheet.
this sheet finally they used to bone into the volumes, like volume 1, volume 2, volume 3, like that. So then if anybody want to trace out the particular specimen, it's a very difficult to trace out. If you want, anybody want Cleom species, how they will go to particular species? It's a very difficult. For that, our father, great father Linnaeus, made great contribution to our herbarium as well as our plant taxonomy. So what he did actually, he said one specimen should be mounted on one herbarium sheet. These sheets we have to arrange as per the approved system of classification. So when we arrange approved system of classification, easily we can retrieve that particular plant specimen. Easily we can study the particular specimen. So actually, where do we find this herbaria? Generally, herbarias usually associate with the universities, colleges, botanical gardens, museum, and research institutes. Herbaria. These, for this all herbaria, index each and every herbarium to give separate acronym it's giving. Actually, this index herbariarum is maintained by New York Botanical Gardens since 1996. If you can see this link, anybody can go, if anybody want to search the particular herbarium, by this clicking this link, you will get all the information about that herbarium. Just you type it. If you know the acronym of the particular herbarium, just you type the herbarium details, you will get the physical location of the particular herbarium and web address and its content. But how many number of species is available? How many number of type specimens is available in that particular herbaria? And the history of herbaria, contact information, who is the curator of that particular institute? And who is associate staff with that particular institute? All the details you will get in this link. Just if you type it, you will get, if you know the acronym. If you don't know the acronym, just you enter that particular herbarium name, you will get the all the details of the herbarium details. So as for the Barbara, New York Botanical Garden, New York Botanical Garden editor, as far as around throughout the world, December 2019, there are 3,300 herbaria we have as of now. It's all together consisting more than 392 million specimens. So these specimens are collected from the past 400 years from different parts of the globe. So these specimens are available in throughout the herbaria in 3,324 herbaria. You can see here the number of the herbaria, the density of the herbaria in the world. Most herbaria is available in the Europe part, so followed by the American. So very least herbaria is available in the African countries. So these are the some of the topmost herbaria in the world, the Paris Herbarium and Kew Herbarium. It's having the highest number of collection. It's coming to our India, the Central National Herbarium. The acronym of the Central National Herbarium is CAL, CAL. It's located in Aura in the bank of the Hooghly River, and the bank of Hooghly River, Kolkata. It's having more than 2.5 million specimens. So this is the position of this central, our herbarium is 30th position in the world. These are the topmost herbarias in the world. So you can see in the 1960s, the number of herbaria is less than 2,000, having 1.149 million specimens only. It's the end of 2019, we are having more than 3,324 herbaria throughout the globe. So altogether is having more than 392 million specimens. So many, almost more than 12,000 staff are associating with this particular herbaria. You can see, coming to our India, you can see there are more than 60 herbaria, it's a very important herbaria, it's available in our India. In the topmost herbaria is the Central National Herbaria. It's located in Howrah on the bank of Hooghly River. The acronym of the herbaria is CAL. It's having more than 2.5 million specimens, followed by the Forest Research Institute Herbaria, Dehradun. This is the second largest herbaria in our India. So coming to our regional center, our Botanical Survey of India, Deccan Regional Center, we are also having good number of specimens in our regional center. We are having more than 20,000 specimens, including 35 type specimens. These are the important herbaria in our India. You can see our BSA herbaria. So coming to our BSA herbaria, we have more than 35,85,986 sheets, herbarium sheets available with us. So each and every herbaria, this our regional centers having herbaria, these regional centers having this many number of herbaria. So we have almost 27,114 type specimen available with us as of now. So most of the time specimen is deposited in the Central National Herbaria, almost 22,000 specimens we have in our Kolkata. So these are the BSI herbaria, almost 50% of our herbaria specimens we have digitized. Once this process is over, we will upload in our website. Like virtual herbaria, you will get the all the information, whatever specimens is available in our India. So then we will see that there are, based upon the function, we have different types of herbaria. There are general herbaria and special type of herbaria. In the general herbaria, we have international herbaria, national herbaria, and local herbaria. International herbaria, actually what it is, actually the major function of the international herbaria, it produce the family and above the level of work, above the level of work. It's containing throughout the globe specimen, especially number of type specimens is more in this particular international herbaria. For example, Kew herbarium and Paris herbarium and Geneva herbarium, Leningrad herbarium, Russia herbarium. We have, these are the some of the example for international herbaria. Coming to our, this major function is the herbaria. If anybody want to study up that particular specimen, particular species or particular genus, loan facilities also available. We can get it from them and we can study in this herbarium and then the, based on the loan, after that we can exchange also those specimen. So coming to our national herbaria also having, we have centrally already I mentioned, Central National Herbarium having more than 2.5 million specimens. We are also having more than four or five countries, Southeast Asian specimen, even especially Burma, Sri Lanka, and even the Nepal part. We have India, almost many of the collections, our neighboring country specimens are deposited in our Central National Herbarium. The major function of these herbaria also, it's producing as a revisions, most of the revisions and producing the national floras and checklist of the country, these national herbaria specimen, it's having the role. Anybody want to study on the particular genus or some families level also, we can also give on the base loan we can give for the study of that particular specimen. This is the southern region. We have MH herbarium, Madras herbarium. This is our Botanical Survey of India, Southern Regional Center herbarium. This is also having more number of collections in our Madras region, Madras herbarium. Coming to local herbaria, this has mostly, this local herbaria produce checklist district floras, checklist of the local and the state, as well as these local herbaria is contributing to the preparation of the national floras. For example, HY, this is a Usmania University herbaria, acronym of the HY is acronym of Usmania University herbaria. SKU, this is the acronym of Sri Krishna Devara University herbaria. AEH, this is the acronym of Andhra University herbaria. So if you, anybody want, just if you, in the index herbaria, if you type it this name, you will get the information of all this information of this particular herbaria. This also provide contributing the providing the our national floras. There are different special type of herbaria we have based upon our function. There are historical herbaria, because our oldest collections are generally, they are maintaining separately in the general herbarium, as well as are separately for only for historical herbarium, they are maintaining separate institute like Linnaean Society Institute for Linnaeus collection. Otherwise, the Wallich herbarium and Decandal herbarium, they are maintaining the general herbarium as a separate section. We are also having Wallich Wallich herbarium, where all separately we are mentioning in our CNH. So these are the some of the historical herbarium. Herbaria also used to collect for the special research program, especially environment impact assessment studies. When they are going to conduct the environment impact assessment studies, they used to collect the herbaria. Even when they are mycology people, plant pathology people, when they are going to the field, they used to collect the plant specimen, because that particular fungi in growing in the particular habitat, special habitat, that type of collections also they are collecting, but they are not having that much significant for the, in the perspective of taxonomy. So these are the different special type of programs also they are conducting, collecting this herbaria. So teaching our student herbaria, many of our research institutions, even many colleges having teaching herbaria, because plants may not here. For that reason, when professors going to teach their student of the particular family, they used to bring that herbarium specimens. With that herbarium specimen, they used to teach the student. Even our BSI also, we are maintaining separate student herbarium in each and every our circles. So this is the student herbarium. Virtual herbarium means already is told, digital form of the specimen, we can call as a virtual herbarium. Already this Kew and Kew herbarium, Geneva herbarium, Paris herbarium, it's already available on the internet. So we are also doing, once is over means we are also upload that particular specimens into our website. So in job related herbaria also is there, especially in the weed control department, they are used to collect the broadleaf weeds and narrow leaves, monocot weeds. So they are having different pesticides for the different specimens. So for that reason also they are collecting this job related herbaria also. There are different kinds of herbaria based upon their function. So you can see already I mentioned the Condole Herbarium at Geneva. They are mentioning is like that. These are the historical collection. Wallich Herbarium at Kew. These are the some of the historical collection. Coming to our India, this is the one of the oldest specimen in our India, collected by Samuel Brown, a British surgeon, in between the Madras and this Tirupati region, Andhra Pradesh Tirupati region. This is the one of the oldest specimen collected in 21 to 23rd June in 1696. This see, you can see the 1696 itself they collected from our region, especially from the Andhra and Madras, in between the Madras that region they collected. They in earlier time, these collection based upon is Samuel Brown collection, James Petiver, he gave some polynomial nomenclature. So finally this accepted binomial nomenclature is Cyperus Procerus. This is the oldest specimen in our India. So coming to our region, we are also having some of the oldest collections. So already mentioned this digitized form. This boy is doing in our regional center is digitization of the entire this whatever we are having specimen, more than 70% already completed. So he is doing that type of work. So in from our regional, we have this is the oldest collection collected by Rotler in 1776. The plant is Cucumicia madras patana. Earlier there is written as a Cucumis madras patana. This collected from Andhra Pradesh from our jurisdiction. So coming to our actually present topic, the role and significance of the herbarium. Actually, what herbaria is the importance in the conservation of plants? What it's the main role of the herbarium? Actually, herbarium is helpful for the identification of the plant specimen. If any layman also can collect particular region's herbarium, they can come and they can visit and the particular herbarium, they can compare the specimen, they can match the herbarium. Based on its matching, it can observe. So we can compare that particular, oh, this is belongs to this species. Like that, you can identify. Herbarium also is useful for the identification of the plant specimen. Altus may not be correct exactly species level, but it will give the at least genus level of identification. Always until we have to go the flora and based on the key value, we have to finalize that specimen identification. Herbarium also useful for the compilation of floras. If anybody want to study the taxonomical work, especially either floras or revisions or monographs, you must go to the field, you have to collect the specimen, you have to make it herbarium. Based on that herbarium only, we can write the this floras, whatever is flora or revision or monograph. Herbarium also useful for the ethnobotanical studies, because when we are going to field, we used to, local people used particular tribes or local people used to associate with us. So at that time, they used to tell, sir, this plant is used for this particular disease, this plant is used for this particular disease. Those all information we used to write on the herbarium label, at the user's label, that in the user's part. These data also will help for the ethnobotanical study. This even herbarium repository of the plant throughout the globe. So this based on venation pattern, so many studies is also, herbarium also helpful for the assessment of the climate. To collect the wild relatives. India is one of the 8 Wavilovian center, because we have very number of wild relatives in our India. So like Oryza species, even as a red gram species, we have so many wild relatives. We have more than 3 wild relatives. These relatives are helpful for the breeding programs. If anybody wants doing genetic plant genetic researches, they can collect, they can see the herbarium details. Based on that herbarium label details, whatever available on the label, based on that information, they can go to the particular area, they can phenology. Without knowing the phenology of the particular species, it's difficult to how we will conserve the species. If you know it itself, when it's the particular seed, if you know these things also, we will able to conserve those data will give clear cut information of the flowering and fruiting of the particular species. So based on that information, we can go wherever that species is available. Based on that, we can go to the particular locality, we can collect that seeds, we can multiply it, then you can repository of pollen and seed material. Herbarium, when we are going to field, we used to collect 3 to 4 specimens. Out of 3 to 4, one only we used anybody want to study in the paleontological studies, they can come and they can study in the this already whatever we have are having existing specimen duplicates. Based on that, we can work on this. So herbarium data also reveal the history of the science. This particular period, earlier actually, those scientists who were botanists explored those areas. They used to write, from this time we traveled to this area. So on that particular date, the scientist was in that. The science also will come to know the based on the herbarium data label. This herbarium sheets also helpful in the giving training to the teachers. Specimen, you can see the another a pinch of material to resolve the taxonomical problem, especially in the cryptic species by the molecular studies. Based on these molecular studies, we can resolve these taxonomical problems. We can see another is the phylogenetic data. So you see California poppy, California 2009. So from that onwards, they are collecting. You can see here that the how it is the plant. Sometimes it's normal, sometimes it's very small. So based on the climate, we can also assess the climate change. It will give very informative for assessment of those climate. So already I mentioned Wallich. He collected 1828 to 1849 more than 20,000 specimens from our all region. So these what he made based on we can call as a Wallich catalog or Wallichian catalog. This is herbarium in our Central National Herbarium. So based on this herbarium details only, he prepared this catalog. So that herbarium is very important for preparation of all these things. So this we can call as a Wallichian catalog. Still, it's available with us in our Central National Herbarium. So this is coming to the very important topic of our present topic, the role of herbarium in conservation. So already I mentioned herbarium having its ample of data. When we are going to field, we used to collect not only plant specimen, we used to collect the ample of data that associates of it associated with associate species, how it is the frequency of this, whether it is rarely we find, occasionally we find, it's very common, the distribution of the species. So this all the information we used to write on the herbarium label. This herbarium label useful for the assessment of endemic or threatened plants species, or if in case of after the type nobody has collected these species, we can assess, we can rediscover those species. We can also study the NDF studies and invasive species environment impact assessment studies. So like this herbarium is useful for many other studies. We can see the assessment of endemic plants. As of now, we have in our India 20,189 species, 89 vascular plants species we have in our India. Of these, 4,381 species belong to 1,007 genera and 176 families are strictly and narrowly endemic to our Indian political boundary. So already I mean, these are the endemic species. Already I mentioned herbarium data label is give full of information about the particular species. What is the scientific name, family, from where you have collected, even which date you have collected, it's belong to which area, latitude, longitude, all these things it's available in this herbarium. Based on this herbarium data, we can go and particular site and we can recollect those species. Already mentioned this after the type, nobody has collected this particular cytokine species from our region. Recently, we recollect after the lapse of 30 years. Still, this is our second collection from our Telangana region. Already mentioned, based on the herbarium label, we can mapping the plant resources also. We can also make mapping. So already mentioned, based on the herbarium data, so we this Ipomoea clarke and endemic species we collected from our jurisdiction is from NSTR, Nagarjuna Sagar Switzerland Tiger Reserve. This is the largest tiger reserve in India. We collected from the part of Telangana region and part of Andhra, eastern ghat of Andhra region. This is eastern ghat portion we collected this particular species. Earlier, these species were collected from only western ghats of this Maharashtra part. Recently, our exploration to the NSTR, we collected these species and we made it. You can see that based on the herbarium also, we can map it like this. So where it's available, the distribution map also we can prepare. That's what herbarium will, when we know this distribution of this particular species, if it is in case rare, we can bring it to our exotic conservation, we will multiply it, then we can introduce into their natural habitat. See one more example, this is cytokline species. Earlier, our father Santapu reported from in 1952 from Maharashtra region of Western Ghats. Recently, our second group assessment studies, we collected from our Telangana region, so from the Kavval Tiger Reserve. This is the locations available for this endemic species of our Indian plant. So like this, so many of these already are mentioned, they went to the only type locality. Nobody has collected from those species again and again, this particular species. This with difficulties, these two species, we relocated from other localities, especially these reported from SHLM Biosphere Reserve and Alamala Forest. We reported from this another different localities. These only we recollected these Brachystelma species. So already I mentioned, herbarium is very useful for the data of the herbarium, useful for the assessment of the threatened plant species. Already mentioned, what herbarium data labels will give geographic distribution of the particular species. It will give the map of that particular species, how the population is there, whether it is rare or it is frequently we observe. The all the details will have on the herbarium label data. This, based on these things, IUCN assessed as a 9 criteria of this. IUCN assessed the 9 criteria of this particular species. These are so among these critical endangered and vulnerable species comes under the this threatened categories. We can see already these are mentioned, Melania angustifolia. As per the IUCN website, still it comes under the extinct category. This in 1998 they assessed as a extinct in category. So these species first actually Ukur described this species based on the white collection collected from the Kottalam in 1880. So after that, in lapse of so many years, Rangachari collected this particular species again. So after so many years, nobody has collected this particular Vanlandia species. Vishwanathan and his team in 1998, they rediscovered this particular species and rediscovered this particular species. Recently, one of our science, Rasingham Sarandi, associated with the other institutions, they assessed this particular, based on that herbarium label, they went to the particular area, they explored nearby more localities, and they assessed as a endangered category. So already mentioned, Ilex dinariana, this is one of the extinct species from our India. After the type locality, no has collected this species described by White in 1859 from the Sitsipara Ghat of Nilagiri Hills, Tamil Nadu. After it's only known from the type locality, after that nobody has collected, because it's repeatedly explored those areas, but no specimen has been found in any other herbarium in our Indian herbarium. So we possibly think this is the extinct species from our India. So as far as this is the unmoored species, it's a critically endangered species, Illegardia populifolia. So this actually it's located, this is critically, this species particularly is endemic to Eastern Ghat portion of the Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh. In between these areas only it's available. It's having less than around 50 major individuals only available. Recent our ABG scheme, some university's team went to the particular area based on their herbarium data they collected, and they are multiplying these species and they will introduce into their natural habitats. So and one more species, this is recently published in Reedia. You can see Maduka diplostema. This is described by White. So in the year 1835 from Kollam area. After that, this area is urbanized. Still, no, but from the type collection, nobody has collected this particular species. So recently, Shailaja Kumari in 2019, she collected from the Sacred Grove and from the Shiva temple. So she assessed this species as a critically endangered species. So only one mature individual is available as of now. So we can also, based on the herbarium data, we can also assess the non-detrimental finding studies. Already mentioned, Sir mentioned about this red sunder. This red sunder, when we are studying the herbarium in CNH, all other Indian herbarium, we found many specimens from the throughout the India, including from Sri Lanka also. I noted those specimens. This was introduced. These species introduced were in before 1900 year also. It's okay. Last, actually, based on this herbarium data, our BSI also did so many biodiversity assessment through the long-term monitoring plots in Indian Himalaya landscape. So many other projects also we did based on our herbarium data. Okay, thank you. Because maybe this time constraint, thank you very much for giving opportunity to present a short topic on herbarium in front of you people. So very thanks to the organizer and our director and head of office and all other technical team of our institute. And thank you so much for patiently listening. My topic. If you have any question, kindly ask us. We will give you.
Yes. The role of herbarium in conservation. Any questions from participants? Kindly mail. Dear participants, if you have any questions. Dear participants, if you wish to ask any question. Nagaraja, please go on. Dear participants, do you have any questions? So now I request to Dr. G. Swarnalatha for a vote of thanks.
Good afternoon to all. On behalf of Botanical Survey of India, Deccan Regional Center, I sincerely thank Dr. A.A. Mavo, Director, Botanical Survey of India, for addressing the webinar. Thanks to Dr. P.V. Prasanna, Scientist G, and Head of the Office, BSI, Deccan Regional Center, for welcome address. I would like to thank Dr. S.S. Das, Senior Scientist from BSI Headquarters, for delivering the keynote address. I also thank our speaker, Dr. L. Rasingham, Dr. Swami, and Mr. Ravikiran for their excellent presentations on various topics. Also, a special thanks to Dr. Shankar Rao, convener, Mr. Nagraj, coordinator, Mr. Sachinarayana, technician, for successfully organizing this webinar. I would like to thank CPWD for Power Supply webinar, organized by our regional center. Thank you. Take good care of yourself from Corona.
Thank you, dear participants. Stay home and stay safe. Thank you all.